Hi guys, I hope all of you are well. We're almost at the end of theme 6, and before we continue, let's just do a quick recap of what we've seen so far in this chapter. We've had a look at how the two main religions, Hinduism and Islam, underwent a change. In the beginning, when Hinduism emerged, it was seen as Vedic Hinduism, and earlier in theme 4, we'd seen how it already underwent a change and became Puranic Hinduism. Well, now Puranic Hinduism is definitely more dominant, but another variety which comes out of it, which is much more open, less orthodox, believes in praying in a very different manner, that was known as Bhakti. So Bhakti came out of Hinduism, and out of Islam came Sufism. Well, both Bhakti and Sufism were against the materialistic cultures of their dominant religions, and they were very tolerant ideologies. They believed in praying and having love for God at a very different level compared to what regular or orthodox Islam or Puranic Hinduism considered to be alright. We then went on to have a look at in detail at the two states in South India which had Bhakti followers, very dominant Bhakti followers, that was Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. We then also saw how Bhakti did not work out very well for North India because it did not get any royal patronage, whereas in South India, the Cholas gave a lot of money, a lot of royal patronage and respect to Bhakti. After that, we moved on to a few details of Sufism, where we saw how a Sufi saint or a chisti was functioning from a hospice, how his disciples, they then went to other places and a silsila got established. We then also saw how Sufism in North India went on to become very dominant and enjoyed royal patronage and a very special position with all the sultans. We've had the look at Muhammad bin Tughlaq, and then we've also, another example would be Akbar. Their tombs began to be regarded as very holy, the tomb shrines. In fact, when Orthodox Muslims only went to Mecca for Hajj, that pilgrimage was called Hajj, but then people also started going to these tomb shrines of the Sufi saints, to the Dargah of the Sufi saint, and this came to be known as Ziyarat. After that, we saw the rise of poets who probably did not start out, I mean not probably, they definitely did not start out with the idea of motivating a cult behind them. They wrote poems because they wanted to inspire people and they wanted others to see what they thought God was. We've already seen Kabir or Sant Kabir and how his writings were incorporated in other religions also. Now as we continue, we see the next person we're going to look at is Guru Nanak. Well, we have to remember, well, today we look at Sikhism like a whole another religion altogether, but it did not start out this way. In fact, Guru Nanak was a Hindu, and when he came up with his ideas, what he wanted to show was that it was possible to be a Hindu without actually, not even just a Hindu, it was just possible to follow your faith without actually having to abide by all these strict orthodox rituals. However, his followers eventually ended up making it another religion altogether. So let's just have a look in detail at Guru Nanak. Well, Guru Nanak, from 1469 to 1539 are his years. His immediate follower or preceptor was Angad, which means the next Sikh leader who came after him, or Sikh guru, in fact, not leader, guru, which came after him was Angad. About Guru Nanak, well, he was born in a Hindu merchant family in a village called Nankana Sahib near the Ravi River in Punjab. So basically, he was born in Punjab. I want you to remember something very crucial at this time before I move ahead. Because Guru Nanak is born in Punjab, he's a Punjabi, right? For example, all of you are, most of you, most of you, since you're born in Gujarat, you will become a Gujarati, right? But Gujarati is not a religion. So in the same way, just because you come from a certain region, you are given that name, it does not mean you also associate with the same religion. Like a lot of people, if they see a Sikh, they start calling them Punjabi. No, do not do that. Punjabi is only going to be a person who is from Punjab. And if some person is from Punjab, it does not always have to mean that they are Sikh. So what Guru Nanak did was the followers of Guru Nanak, they started this cult or this religion called Sikhism. Alright, so I want you to differentiate between region Punjab and the religion Sikhism. Anyway, so we have a lot of Punjabis. Out of them, some are Hindu, some are Muslim, some are Christians, some are Parsis, and then most of them are also Sikhs because, well, their Guru is from that place. So, of course, it will have more influence in that very area. So, just remember this little crucial detail. Alright, so he was born in Punjab. He was trained to be an accountant and he married at a young age and he travelled widely. His hymns and teachings advocate Nirguna Bhakti. Where in the beginning of the chapter, we had a look at how Bhakti is of two kinds, Saguna and Nirguna. In Saguna, God has attributes, which means you may give God a certain form, could have a certain gender also if you'd like. Then the second was Nirguna Bhakti, where you did worship, but that God did not have any gender, it did not have any attributes, it did not have any design, it did not look a certain type, but you believed in the idea that God was just present everywhere. So Guru Nanak advocated Nirguna Bhakti. He rejected external practices of religions, sacrifices, ritualistic baths, image worship, etc. So like I said, his idea was not to suddenly leave his religion. He was born in a Hindu family, so he was a Hindu, started out as a Hindu. His idea was not to suddenly leave Hinduism, but his idea was definitely to condemn Hinduism and its orthodox practices which were hurting others. Apart from that, he also went on to condemn other religions because they also have ritualistic baths and sacrifices. Guru Nanak did not believe that you had to follow such practices to show that you were devoted to your God. He said that Rab, that's what he called his God, Rab was absolute and had no gender and no form. See, very different from what most of the dominant religions of the world follow. God, their God has, most of our gods have genders, they have a certain form, they look a certain way, they have certain powers for that matter. But not the God of Guru Nanak. He said, a similar idea if you remember to Kabir, you know, absolute God. Everywhere, there's so many names, but then that God is just one. It's us who've divided God into so many ways and genders and forms and all of that. So, well, Guru Nanak also said that this Rab is absolute, this Rab is whole, and Rab has no gender or no form. He wrote his hymns in Punjabi and they came to be known as Shabd. He organized his followers into a community and set up rules for congregational worship, and this congregational worship was known as Sangat, where they invoked collective recitation. So he did organize his followers into a community, but then again, remember, this community was not supposed to become a religion. He did not wish to establish a new religion, but his followers distinguished themselves from both Hindus and Muslims. People from different walks of life, different religions got attracted to his principles, and they finally decided, his ardent followers, that we are neither Hindus, we are neither Muslims, because we're not following a lot of their rituals, so might as well we become another religion of our own. And that is what happened. The fifth guru, so basically there are 10 Sikh gurus. The first Sikh guru was Guru Nanak, who started Sikhism. His immediate follower was Angad. Now we're talking about the fifth guru. Fifth guru was Guru Arjan, And he compiled Guru Nanak's hymns and those of Kabir and Baba Farid in the Adi Granth Sahib. These hymns are called the Gurbani. See, so these hymns have been taken from various poets across religions because they all believe in the same thing, that God has no gender, God has no form, God is absolute. And they all were compiled and put in the Adi Granth Sahib, which is also the holy book of the Sikhs. These hymns came to be known as Gurbani. The 10th Guru, Guru Gobind Singh, laid the foundation of the Khalsa Panth or the army. So the 10th Guru did this and composed the Guru Granth Sahib by putting compositions of the 9th Guru. Before the 10th Guru, we had the Adi Granth Sahib. That was what the book was called. Finally, the 10th Guru, Guru Gobind Singh, went on to make the Guru Granth Sahib. He also established the Sikh army known as Khalsa. He also included a lot of compositions of the 9th Guru, and the 9th Guru's name was Guru Tegh Bahadur. Well, members of the Khalsa Panth or the Khalsa army were identified by uncut hair, a dagger, a pair of shorts, a comb and a steel bangle. So basically they carried all of these things with them. A dagger, a pair of shorts, a comb and a steel bangle and uncut hair. A lot of times when you meet people from the Sikh community, they would be following at least one of these, if not all five. And of course, as history shown it, this Khalsa Panth will then eventually went on to become a socio-religious military force, which later, when the British come to India, is going to cause problems for them. And it's really interesting to look at the history, but since it's not in your syllabus, I'm not going to go into it. Okay, thank you.